Thank you all so much for coming to Students for Cooperation's first educational conference on UMC campus promoting student cooperatives and student cooperation. Thank you so much for everyone who came out. Thank you especially to the presenters. We're really looking forward to hearing from all of you. My name is Tristan. I'm the president of the club. I'm also the president external of campus cooperative residences. Hey. And I'm here to introduce to you our facilitator slash chair, Miriam from WCRI. Miriam is the former president of WCRI and a current staff member. So let's welcome her hand.
Hi everyone, can hear me, right? Just checking, cool. So I'll be facilitating today's event. We have a great round of speakers today, so without further ado, I'd like to call Jack. Jack's going to speak about his personal experience at CCRI in the 60s and how they influenced him in his subsequent choices, and it all started with a co-op experience when he was young, so we'll see how that led him to where he is.
This opportunity gave me a chance to reflect on days long gone by. I was a member of Campus Co-op from 1963 to 1965. I was 21 when I first moved in King House and subsequently own house, both on Spadina and Wilcox. And it's 55 years ago, so it's a, you know, memories can play tricks on you after 55 years. But I was just starting my MA in social psychology. I was 21 years old, as I said. And I have fond memories of that period. I mean, very fond memories. Maybe not for the right reasons, but we had parties every weekend, regular trips to the Silver Dollar at the College of Spadina, and lively discussions every evening in the kitchen for as long as you could stay awake. And of course, there was a price to be paid at the end of the year, and in King House in particular, first house I lived in, all of the first year students failed their year. Many were in engineering, and it was a bit sad after such a fun year. Those of us who were a bit older were a bit more fortunate, but I wasn't a co-op activist in any sense, and the only thing I can remember about the co-op was one particular meeting when the general manager at that time, Howard Edelman, who subsequently became a philosophy professor at York University, announced that the co-op was going to undergo a major expansion. And the board had approved it. So there was a meeting of the membership. It was at Hart House. I can visualize it clearly. The Campus Co-op was a nonprofit, and as a nonprofit, its revenue sources for financing an expansion were to remortgage the existing houses, and it was a good time to do it, and to raise student fees, which had to be done if the existing houses were to be remortgaged to finance the expansion. Well, needless to say, the people who were living in Campus Co-op were furious, and I thought for a few minutes that we'd be reenacting the crucifixion, because people were just enraged, and I'll never forget that meeting. It wasn't very pleasant to sit through. in reflecting on it, I think, you know, the co-op made the right decision. But, you know, it drove home that within a co-op, there are different interest groups. And for those of us who were residents at the time, swallowing a sizable fee increase the next year wasn't a pleasant thought. But in any case, I moved out of the co-op in 1965, and I didn't really think that much about the experience other than the people I knew there, and I sometimes wondered how they made out in life. And I became a faculty member at OZ in 1972. And for the first years or so, my field of research was the student movement. And I felt like I needed a spark. And I was floundering a little bit. And in 1980, I had a sabbatical, and my family and I went. I got a visiting professorship at the University of Haifa, and we lived on a kibbutz in Israel. And it was, in many ways, a life-changing experience because the kibbutz had a very large agricultural cartons factory. And I remember observing it, and when the assembly line broke, watching how people working on it scurried about trying to fix it as quickly as possible. And I can remember as a student working on assembly lines, and when the assembly line broke, these were summer jobs, you know, just praying that it took forever to fix it. And I realized that I was witnessing something that was quite unique, worker self-management. And I became quite engaged in that topic, and it became a passion for me. When we returned, I became part of a small group that was putting out a newsletter called the Worker Co-op, and I became involved with some research through the Cooperative College in Saskatoon. It no longer exists. In 1990, I was part of the organizing group for the Canadian Worker Cooperative Federation. It was a meeting before the federation was formed, a year later. But it was basically all the people that were associated with the newsletter plus a few others. And about this time, I began to broaden my range of interests. And I began to see that the concept of mutual aid, which the Russian biologist Peter Kropotkin described quite vividly as a founding characteristic of cooperatives, was very, very central to nonprofit mutual associations of many sorts. Union locals, social clubs, professional associations, religious congregations, ethnocultural associations, and so on. And in 1992, I wrote this book called Canada's Social Economy, which was probably the first account of the social economy, broadly speaking, in English Canada. And from that point forward, I became very engaged in a series of research topics on the social economy, volunteering, social accounting, nonprofit social enterprises, serving marginalized social groups, which is the field I'm working in at this point in time most closely. So when I think back over the 55 years or so when I first started a campus co-op in 76 at this point, and when I think back over those 55 years, I ask myself the question, did my experience at campus co-op propel me in the direction that I took? Well, like many questions, I don't know the answer, but it's something I've been thinking about since Tristan asked me to speak. So I think I went over my 5 minutes, but that's
thanks so much, Jeff.